Susan McKinley Ross, and I'm going to talk about epiphanies, design epiphanies from Qwirkle and other games. The first thing I want to talk about is what is a design epiphany? And for me, a design epiphany is that glorious, joyous moment when you're working on something and all of a sudden you understand a design concept that you didn't understand before. For me, it usually happens when I'm trying to solve a problem, I'm banging my head against the wall, how can I figure this out? And all of a sudden, I see it clearly and I understand viscerally something that I didn't understand before. And what I've noticed is that these design epiphanies are applicable to future things. They don't just solve the problem I'm working on, but if I remember them, I can use them to solve future problems. The other thing I want to do is give you a brief introduction to Qwirkle, because I'm going to be talking about it a lot, and you're going to want to know what the game is. It's an abstract strategy board game. It consists of 108 wooden tiles, and you use the tiles to make lines that are either all the same shape or all the same color. At the beginning of the game, the decision tree is pretty small. The scoring is very close to Scrabble, and for instance, if you played those two orange tiles, you would score 4 points for the star line and 2 points for the orange line, so you'd get 6 points. And then the game goes on, the decision tree gets more interesting, there's more choices. For instance, if you played the two yellow tiles, you'd score 3 points for the X line, I think it's 3 points for the star line, I can't see from here, and 2 points for the yellow line. So you'd get 8 points. And then at the end of the game, there's some more interesting scoring opportunities and you can make Qwirkles. You can do this in the middle of the game, but it's less likely. So for instance, if you played that orange diamond on the middle bottom, you would make a Qwirkle because there's 6 shapes and 6 colors and you can't have any duplicates in a line. For instance, you can't have 2 red squares and a red line or a square line. So when you finish a line of 6, it's called a Qwirkle, and you score 12 points. 6 points for the tiles, just like normal, and a 6-point bonus. And 12 points is a lot in Qwirkle. So that's just a basic introduction to Qwirkle, and it'll be coming up a lot, so I wanted you to know how you play it. The first design epiphany I want to talk about is pay attention to inspiration. And this is probably the first design epiphany any designer has. For me, I was working at a toy company, and they put out a call for toy ideas, and I was like, I can think of something, and I'll turn it into a toy. I was so excited. I turned in 200 toy ideas, and it really, that's when I learned how exciting inspiration is and how much I wanted to design products. So I learned this very early on, but I've learned more about it as I've gone on, because part of game design can be really boring and kind of tedious. In the later part of game design, you're playing a game over and over and over again because you're trying to solve a little bit of a problem and make it smooth, completely smooth. And so what happens is when you have that inspiration, when you have that moment of, oh, this is a good idea, I can't think about anything else, I want to try this, I want to try that, I want to get it down on paper, get it down on paper. Work on it as soon as you can. Work on that prototype, make it as soon as you can, because that inspiration can carry you really far in the game design process. And the farther you go when you're inspired, the less far you have to go when it's kind of tedious and boring. So knowing that, when I had the inspiration for Qwirkle, I was able to get up that morning and make the first paper prototype. So my friends, Jessica Barnett and Dave Grossman, are both really good Scrabble players. I'm not a good Scrabble player, but they were at our house playing a game and I was watching them just for the joy of watching their game. And I realized what I love about Scrabble is when you make 2 words at once, when you're playing in 2 different directions. And this, of course, was happening a lot because they're really good Scrabble players. And then a couple nights later, I woke up in the morning and I had a vision in my dream of basically a finished Scrabble board, a Qwirkle board. And I saw something like this and I got up and I said, I'm going to go make that right now, because I knew the value of inspiration. I knew I'd seen this. I knew I wanted to work on it right away. I knew that the sooner I got it made, the more likely it would be like the thing that inspired me. So this is the very first Qwirkle prototype. Obviously, it changed and evolved from that, but that was the one I made that morning when I had the inspiration. Another game that happened that moved really far along because of inspiration is Surplexed. So I was working on a game and I could not figure out the scoring. I still haven't figured out the scoring. It's a fun game. I should play it with some more people because it's a good game, but I could not figure out the scoring. No matter what I tried, it just didn't work. And so I was thinking about this and thinking about this and thinking about this, and I decided I'm going to take a nap because I work at home and I get to take a nap. So I took a nap, and I woke up, and I was lying there in that kind of sleepy, groggy state, and the idea for surplexed came to me. And surplexed is really, really simple scoring. All you score are circles that are one solid color. That's it. The scoring is intuitive. And I really think my brain got sick of thinking of the other scoring problem and said, here's another game, just get over that scoring issue. So I had the idea for this. I got up, I made the first prototype that evening, made it out of paper, started playing it, and it changed and evolved too. But I got really far along in the design because I acted on the inspiration when I had it. The next design epiphany I want to talk about is being stuck as part of the process. Darn it. My husband and I were working on the Qwirkle app. We weren't developing it. MFV did a really nice job on it, but we were playing it and giving feedback. And I got up one morning and pulled out my iPad to start working on it, and it didn't work. Everything was broken. It wouldn't play. Nothing worked. And I was freaking out because I was like, it worked yesterday. Everything made sense yesterday. And my husband got up and he looked down and he said, well, you know, it's part of the process. Everything breaks and then it gets fixed and it works again. And this was an epiphany for me because I'd spent most of my career working alone, and even though many of my games broke in the middle, I hadn't realized it was part of the process. And when Chris said it, he had been working in the video game industry for 14 years before I hired him away to do board games. And when he said it, and I realized whole teams of people would get in the situation where they got stuck and their game got broken, and then it worked again, it really helped me be calm about what happened. And it actually, the next day, everything worked perfectly. And it's helped me in future game design since then to realize that it's just part of the process. You reach a point where everything seems impossible, and that happens, and you keep going, and you keep trying, and eventually you find a solution. Hopefully an epiphany. The next one I want to talk about, add more bingos. So this one, we have a monthly game night that we've hosted since 1998, and we had friends over who were playing. They were very gracious early playtesters of Qwirkle, and they were playing the early version there shown with eight shapes and eight colors and two of each tile. And my friend Andrew Kermsey played it, and he said, it's a good game, it's kind of interesting, but it needs more bingos. And I just thought, oh, that's so smart, it needs more bingos. You need more minor victories, you need more personal victories, you need more moments of, oh, I made a good play. And so I thought about it and thought about it, and eventually what happened is Qwirkle evolved into six shapes, six colors, three of each tile, and that definitely increases your opportunities for bingos, or in this case, Qwirkles, because it was much easier to score a line of six than to score a line of eight, and there were three of each tile. So doing that, ever since then, I've thought about the games I've designed and tried to add more bingos to them, because I've played games, and I realized that there's lots of times where there's a small victory in a game. You get a Yahtzee, you get a bingo in Scrabble, you get a Qwirkle. Something like that happens, and it makes you feel good about the game. And you may not win the game, but at least you have that moment of victory when you get that small little goal met. And so I've been trying to add more bingos to my games ever since the beginning. This is Skippity. So Skippity is basically my version of checkers, but in checkers, it takes a while before you start to get to make jumps. And in this one, you're making jumps from the very first turn, and every turn, there's double jumps, triple jumps, quadruple jumps. And each of those are a little bit of a bingo. And then you're trying to collect sets, one piece of each color. When you have a set, there's a bingo. The person with the most sets at the end of the game wins. And so Skippity is kind of my version of checkers with more bingos. When Qwirkle won the Spiel des Jahres, the German publisher asked me to come up with an expansion for Qwirkle, and it took a really long time to figure out what that was going to be. This is the first expansion that came out for Qwirkle, and it's a set of boards. They're double-sided. I'm just going to talk about one side. So I was working on an expansion for Qwirkle, and I wanted to add more bingos to Qwirkle. And so Qwirkle Select has little spaces on the board, and you put the little wooden star tokens on the board. And when you get to a spot that has a select token, you get to take the select token, from the board and add it to your hand. And then on any future turn, you can spend the token and take a piece off the board and add it to your hand. So if you need a red square to finish a Qwirkle, you just take it off the board. So there's a bingo of when you get the select token, the bingo of when you use it. And usually there's more Qwirkles in a select game because there's more opportunities because of the select tokens. So those are all cases for me where adding more bingos was really important to my game design. Write the rules early and often. Oh, I wish I'd learned this earlier. I was working on Qwirkle cards, and Qwirkle cards was a tough nut for me to crack. I took a lot of time to figure out a fun game there. And what I normally do in my playtesting process is I play a game a lot against myself, and then I take it to playtesters and get their response, and then I go back and revise it, and then I take it to playtesters and get their response, and then I go back and revise it, and it's a lot of that. And I normally don't write the instructions to the end because it almost seemed like a waste of time to me to put them down when they're just going to be changing. So I would just give the playtesters verbal rules. And so I was working on Qwirkle cards, and I was playtesting with my husband, Chris, and he said, please, can you give me some written rules? And I said, why? And he said, I played so many different versions of this game, Qwirkle cards. I can't remember what the rules are when you tell me anymore. Can you just write them down so I can see them? And I said, sure, that's no big deal. And I sat down to write them, and I immediately realized how powerful it was. Because as I was writing them, I was like, oh, that's really hard to explain. If it's this hard to explain in writing, it doesn't make sense for one of my games. It's too complex a rule. And I realized from that point on that when I was writing the rules early and I was writing them often, it helped me with the game design. It helped me figure out how to smooth things out and how to make the games clearer from the very beginning. And then the other part is writing game rules is hard. You have to strike this balance between being very clear about 90% of the cases and being very legal about the 10% of outlier cases. And it's almost this balance between clear language and very legal language and figuring it out. And when I started writing my rules early and keeping drafts of them and writing them over and over in the design process, I found that the language got better and better each time. And when it was time to write the final rules and turn it into the publisher, it was much easier because I'd done all this work. So it helped both the game design and the final writing of the rules. The last epiphany I want to talk about, prototypes are powerful. I also think of this as what you show is what you get. And my experience is probably a little different from most designers. Designers and publishers will both tell you don't have to have a perfect prototype when you send it in, and I think that's true. I think publishers are able to see a game and decide if it's good, whether or not the art and the prototype are perfect. But I think there's real value in when you show a publisher a prototype, it's as close as it can be to what you want it to be. And the reason is that way, when they license it, they have the same idea in mind as you do. You're agreeing on what you want the product to be, and you're seeing the same thing. If you give them a prototype that isn't completely thought out and that isn't an expression of what you want, then they're going to start thinking of it that way, and they're going to take it a different direction. So I want to just show some examples of products that I submitted to publishers and how what I got back really reflects what I showed them. So this is GeoColor Cards Kit. It was way before coloring was cool, so I missed the boat on that one. I was too early on the boat. And I submitted this to a company called Hearthsong, and one of their core values was not to spend money on packaging. They really felt it was important to spend their money on the product and not waste money on packaging. That was really important to them. And I submitted this coloring card kit, and I wanted it in a hinged pencil box so that it would have a use beyond just when you got it and that it would feel like a real stationery set. And I didn't have a plain white box. I had a pretty purple box. So I sent it in a pretty purple box. And they got it, and they said they were going to license it, and they put it in a pretty purple box. And it's only because they saw it in a pretty purple box that I got a pretty purple box. If I'd sent it in a white box, I'd have a white box. So that was really amazing to me. I realized, hey, I can trick them into giving me good packaging. And it worked. So here's another example. This is Qwirkle. I submitted it under the name Abstrackle. Luckily, the publisher came up with the name Qwirkle, which is a much, much much better name. But other than that, they didn't change very much. You can see that they chose the same shapes, they chose the same colors, the tiles are the same size as the ones I did. They didn't change anything in the rules. Luckily, they came up with a better name. But what I showed them is what they ended up producing. So there's a good argument that my games are very graphic and the art isn't that hard, and that's true, I can make my own art. But this is a game that I submitted to Peaceable Kingdom, and they do a great job of hiring children's book illustrators to add the art to the game. And so I submitted this board for Hoot Owl Hoot. It doesn't have any art and it's purely graphic. And they still took the form of it and they added beautiful art on it. So you don't have to hire an illustrator to do all the art for your game. You just want to make the design really good when you send it to the publisher, and then they can layer the art on top of it. This is Skippity. It's a warning tale. So when I submitted this to Mindware, I submitted it with plastic checker pieces and this beautiful wild board that's rainbow colored. And I like lots and lots of color in my designs. And so I made a really pretty board. And it turns out, A, I think if I'd submitted it with wooden pieces, I'd have wooden pieces. B, it's not a great board for gameplay. And the reason is people look at it and they get confused. They think that the colors on the board mean something, and they don't. They're just there to look pretty. So it intimidates people in a way that they don't need to be intimidated. And I submitted it to Mindware this way, and they tried a bunch of different designs and they didn't come up with anything they liked better, so they went back to my original design. So these are mistakes that I made on the prototype that came through on the final one. If I had it to do over again, I would do wooden checker pieces and I would do a calmer board that doesn't confuse people. And I may have it to do over again. We're considering reissuing it in a different format. Color Sticks. So Color Sticks is a product that Mindware had for 2 years before they figured out how to manufacture it. I made it at home with, I cut the wooden sticks and I wrapped them with paper stickers. It's a game where you're lining the stickers up to, or the sticks up to make blocks of color. And they had it for 2 years trying to figure out how they could manufacture it. And in the end, they found a manufacturer who would do the same thing I did in my prototype. They had wooden sticks with stickers wrapped around them. They tried a bunch of different things in between, but they came back to this. And I think part of it is that this is what they saw at the beginning and they knew how well it worked for the gameplay. So when they tried other forms, they didn't work as nice for the gameplay. They ended up having to cut the number of sticks in the game. I think I originally had 60 and it went down to 42. And that was largely because that's what they had to do to get the nice quality of components. But it went back to the way that I had originally produced it. And this is Surplexed. It's the last one I'm going to talk about. So this is the game that I had the idea for, and I woke up and I made it right away from my nap. And I thought this game would be made on chipboard tiles. The publisher made chipboard tile games. They also made wooden tile games, but it's four-color printing. I didn't think they'd want to do that. And my husband was working on the prototype, and it was really hard to make very nice chipboard tiles that were going to line up the way we wanted them to for this game. Just the pre-made ones weren't working very well. Cutting our own wasn't working at all. And so he decided to make a wooden prototype. And I said, well, they're not going to make it out of wood, but sure, that works. And so we took it to Toy Fair and we showed it to Mindware. They loved it. They took the game away it was, and they produced it in wood. And if I'd shown them a chipboard prototype, I wouldn't have gotten a final wooden one. So it's just, I think it's really important that when you show your game to the publishers, it's as close as it can possibly be to what you want it to be. Ooh, I talked really, really fast. I'm done. does anybody have any questions?
So, pretty much every game you've got uses not just color, but a lot of different colors together. And I'm working on a board game prototype right now that uses six colors and kind of has them in an ascending order. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I worry about as I'm working on it is that's too there's colors and there's numbers right now. That's the two primary things that the players are interacting with, and I'm worried that that's too much. Like, it feels like six colors is kind of a lot. Do you have any experience in terms of your own designs of you know, when do people get overwhelmed, you know, other than, you know, with the board where the colors were there for aesthetic reasons, but not mechanical ones, do you have any advice on how to use color in an effective mechanical way that people don't get overwhelmed by it?
Is your game aimed at the family market or more adult players?
I definitely say more adult players.
More adult players. I was just going to say that the rainbow works really, really well for the family market. It's something that is just prevalent in kids' toys. I don't think six colors would be overwhelming, and I think I have no regrets that Qwirkle isn't appropriate for colorblind players. I wish it was, but it wouldn't have sold as well. I think it's something to pay attention to. I'm really impressed by games that realize that their market is going to have gamers who are colorblind. So if you can include something that helps with colorblind issues too, I don't think six colors is going to be overwhelming. But if you can also address that in some way, and if you're aiming for the gamers market, they're more used to games that address the colorblind issues than the family market is. Does that help?
Thank you. Yeah, I didn't even think about that. Yeah, definitely. Thank you.
I'm Saurabh Chen from Fun To Do Labs. So basically, we are trying to use board games for teaching children, and especially in country like India. I'm from India. So there, the quality of government schools is pretty low. So right now we are working on some board games for, like, because teachers don't teach and children don't study because teachers are not good and the infrastructure is not good. So we are using board games. So do you think board games have a can basically do what schools and teachers do? Do they have that power? And the second thing is, when you license that, because we have not figured out the business model till now. So when you license to a toy manufacturer, so how much royalty can you expect, or some other terms? How much royalty or some other payments you can expect?
Okay. So the first question is, how can games, or can games be used in education?
Can games be a, like, I know games are used in education, but can they sort of not exactly replace schools, but can they be 25 or 30% of the education which is done in schools? Like, generally, right now, you have just Scrabble and those kind of games, but can they be a big part of education?
I don't know how big a part of education they can be, but I continue to be impressed by teachers using games in interesting ways to teach interesting things. And I hope you're aware of the cooperative games movement and genre. I think it's really interesting how that's being used for project-based learning in schools, and it's teaching children to work together to solve a problem instead of just compete against each other. So there's a lot of stuff out there on different ways teachers are using games in the classroom and in after-school programs. I don't know as much about it, but I'm excited when I see it happening. And the other question is about when you license something, what can you expect?
Yes.
Okay. So I went to a toy and game conference about 15 years ago. And it's obviously a little bit out of date, but the information that was given to me is that it's very common for royalty rates to be between 3 and 10%. Now, I've never seen anything as high as 10%, but I know it can happen. And what they also said is that the most standard rate is 5%. And that's the information I got from the conference. And it's not that far from what I've experienced.
Okay.
And that's of the wholesale price, because most publishers are selling, they get the wholesale amount of the money and they give you 5 or 10% of that.
Okay. Thanks.
Hi.
Hello.
Qwirkle is so amazing.
Yay!
I love how it is so simple and just, like, makes sense, and I can, like, teach it to somebody in, like, 2 minutes. So I was wondering, like, such a game that kind of just fits together so well, what was your iterative process on it? Like, what problems did you run into while you were making it?
Well, thank you. That's very exciting that you enjoy Qwirkle. That almost makes my day. The Add More Bingos was really, really helpful because I had the basic gameplay of playing in two lines at once. Like I said, that's what I enjoy about Scrabble. It took a while to figure out the shapes had to be symmetrical within a square. So it took a bunch of designing, and then I was like, oh, if I sit on the other side of the table, you know, not everything lines up. You want to make it so that wherever you're sitting, you're seeing the exact same thing. And whichever way you turn the tile, it's you see the exact same thing so that the board would look uniform. Because on one of the earlier slides, you probably can't get back to it, you can see that the shapes aren't symmetrical within a square and they can be turned topsy-turvy. Like if you used hearts or something, it wouldn't work as well. I think figuring out what the bonuses were going to be and how the ending was going to work, these are all parts that I remember being a little bit stuck on and then figuring out how they were going to go together. And ever since Qwirkle, I've tried to make my games as much as possible. Hopefully you learn them and the rules are intuitive enough that you can remember them and you don't have to refer to the rules that often. I hope. That's what I try.
Yeah, thank you. Well, one of the things I love about Qwirkle is like I can play it and I don't really care about score. Like I've had friends, we just like sit down and try to make a pretty thing by the rules.
That's great. Thank you.
Hello, Susan. I'm really impressed by your talk. I'm a student from NYU Game Center, and I'm studying game design. So I have a question that I agree with you that the points in the middle of the whole design process, but I have a question that every time I get an assignment or I want to make a game, I always feel my brain is blank at the very beginning. I have no ideas what can I do. But if I'm working in a group that some of the other group members give brief ideas, so I can contribute to that ideas and develop the whole things better. But for myself, if I want to design something, it's very hard to begin with. So I want to ask, do you have any experience to share that how you get the very beginning ideas?
I take a nap. There's a couple things that I've had really good luck with, and it's exciting that one of the things that works for you is collaborative design, having somebody to work with.
Yeah.
I think I'm more of a control freak, so I'm less good at that. I'm more into doing it all myself.
Yeah.
One of the things I enjoy about design is when somebody gives me parameters, so it's not just a completely blank slate.
Okay.
But I had a publisher ask me for a cooperative dice game. And as soon as they said those three words, I was like, oh, I know what it's going to be. And I started working on it, you know, almost the minute I got off the phone with them because I was so excited about working on a cooperative dice game. So sometimes when I'm trying to come up with something new, it helps if I have some parameters to work with. That can help get me inspired. And then it sounds like for your process, talking to other people helps get you inspired. So just do what works for your process and see if that can help.
Okay, thank you very much.
And good luck on your program. That sounds really neat.
Hi. Two things. First, thank you for Qwirkle. And thing number two, one of your epiphanies was being stuck is part of the process.
Darn it.
Yep. I wasn't sure if I was going to say that on mic, but it has been said. I was curious if you'd expound upon it, because I imagine pretty much any game designer experiences that. Often, if not, if they've never experienced it, I'm shocked.
Me too.
But what are things that you do that when you're stuck in the process other than recognizing that it is a natural part of the evolution?
I didn't put this epiphany in there, but one of the things for me is realizing that the most important component of game design and probably any design is time. And when I'm stuck, if I just make myself do the work and play the game over and over, it will suggest different things to try. So I'll play it against myself. I'll be like, I can't figure this problem out. I can't figure this problem out. I'm like, you have to play it anyway. You just have to play it anyway. And I'll keep playing it against myself until my brain says, well, try this. See if it works. And so it's just the repetitive playing when you're stuck. You know, at some point, I do give up and take a nap, and I never figured out the scoring on that game ever. It's still a good game. It's still, the scoring makes no sense. But usually, it's the time and making myself go back to a design that isn't working that helps me push through it. Because when I'm actually playing about it, instead of just thinking about it and fretting about it, I can see more solutions to try and see if any of them work out. So that's what works for me.
Thank you very much.
Hi. You're one of the few designers at this point that is working almost exclusively in abstract games, as opposed to really having strong themes and thematic games and things like that. What are your thoughts? Do you think that theme is not necessary, or it gets in the way, or it's just kind of the aesthetic that you enjoy?
It's definitely an aesthetic I enjoy, and I love themes. I play a bunch of themed games. I think themes are getting better all the time. And particularly ever since Pandemic came out, I've been a fan of it. I think it does an excellent job. And there's other games that I think really, really do a good job with theme. I don't seem to do a very good job with theme. And I have a couple themes that I'm excited about. I have that inspiration. And when I sit down to work on them, I can't work from theme. I need a mechanic. And these themes that have come to me that I'm like, oh, that would be a cool game if you got to do A, B, or C. None of them have turned into actual games that I can even play with my beginning play testers. They're just things where I play them against myself and get frustrated. So it just seems to be that my brain thinks of them as abstract. And I've had some where they're pasted on themes. Hoot Owl Hoots has the owls on it. And I think that works really, actually that theme works really well because kids like the idea of getting the owls back to the nest before the sun comes up. But in general, my brain just seems to think in abstract terms, and when I come up with a theme, I wish I could make a game. It just hasn't worked so far.
Excellent. Thank you.
Yeah, we don't have questions. We don't have time for questions anymore, okay. But if you would like to continue it in a wrap-up room, you'd be more than welcome to.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Yes. Thank you.
I tried to pretend I couldn't lie for so long.